handful of you here that was not very heartfelt. It sounded like three people are awake. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Yeah, you smart, Alex. I can hear you too. All right. Coming events. Palm Sunday is next week, correct? Am I got that right? Am I right? Okay. All right. The day after that will be a board meeting. Then Easter Sunday, 2 weeks from today. Make sure you bring everybody for that one. That's a good one. Mother's Day is May 8th. May 15th is Beach Day. And Family and Friends Day at BCBC. And we're going to have food. If I'm not mistaken, we're having hot dogs, a beach-themed hot dog day. And then on June 19th, I've discovered that I will not be here. Because I will be on vacation. I did. I tried. I tried. But there are certain rules that I'm not allowed to break. So, unfortunately, I'm going to be with my family as well up in the UP. So, I have to tell you that now. In any event, that being said, it is time to walk across the aisle and greet everybody in the name of the Lord and give somebody a hug. Gentleman already dressed and sitting on the bed with a suitcase at his feet, who insisted he did not need my help to leave the hospital. After a chat with him about rules being rules, he reluctantly let me wheel him to the elevator. On the way down, I asked him if his wife was meeting him. I don't know, he said. She's still in the bathroom changing out of her hospital gown. Yeah. A guy goes into a bar and orders a beer. As he takes a sip of his beer, he hears a little tiny voice say, "Nice tie." He looks around but sees no one. He takes another sip of his beer and hears, "That's a nice shirt, too." Again, he looks around and sees no one. Another minute goes by and he hears, "That's a really nice haircut." He signals the bartender over and hesitantly explains that he's hearing voices talking to him. He says, "Of course," smiles the bartender, "it's the peanuts. They're complimentary." That's great. I love that one. An 87-year-old man went to the doctor to get a physical. A few days later, the doctor saw the man walking down the street with a gorgeous lady on his arm. A couple of days later, when the old man had an appointment with the doctor again, the doctor said, "You're really doing great, aren't you?" The man replied, "I'm just doing what you said, doctor. Got a hot mama and be cheerful." He said, "I didn't say that. I said, you have a heart murmur. Be careful." A well-worn $50 bill and a similarly distressed, a well-worn $5 bill and a similarly distressed $50 bill arrived at the Federal Reserve Bank to be retired. As they moved along the conveyor belt to be burned, they struck up a conversation. The $50 bill reminisced about his travels all over the country. "I've had a pretty good life," the 50 proclaimed. "Why, I've been to Las Vegas, Atlantic City, the finest restaurants in New York, performances on Broadway, and even on a cruise to the Caribbean." "Wow," said the $5 bill, "you really had an exciting life." "So tell me," says the 50, "where have you been through your lifetime?" The $5 bill replies, "Oh, I've been to the Methodist Church, the Baptist Church, the Lutheran Church." The $50 bill interrupts quickly and says, "What's a church?" Touche! Huh? All right. Well, that's all good and well for joking around, but now you got to sing. So you got to stand up. And I was told that we were going to do this Thrive YouTube. So check it out.
Unstoppable, anything is possible. Joy unspeakable.
redeemed. How I love to proclaim it. Carlos fell. you didn't know that already, Carlos fell. I hear he's not in very good shape. So, definitely want to make sure we pray for Carlos and his family. Just out of curiosity, what happened? He fell, I heard?
He fell off the top step, and he landed his feet right on the face.
Oh.
And he got like 40 or 50 in his forehead.
Oh, my gosh.
And he broke his neck, and they had to go in and put a plate in. And then from doing that, it swelled, and it cut his airway off. So they got him on the ventilator so they can get the swelling down.
Oh, poor Carlos. Yeah, we love that guy. He's one of our favorites, too. What else? Somebody told me about something else. Go ahead, Sandy. Go ahead.
I believe there's a church in Urbana that burned.
Yep, Urbana Reformed burned to the ground yesterday. Was it yesterday? Was it yesterday morning? Yeah. Sandy and Andy. Yeah, Carol. This isn't as full in here without her playing, is it? You know, we love you, Mom. You're great, but without Carol, something just seems to be, there's a piece of the puzzle missing. We love you, Carol. Say, Dad. Oh, okay. Go ahead, Ginger.
I'd like to continue prayers for Jeannie Chapman, Dominic's grandmother.
Yeah, we think about her a lot. No, what I see, she's doing a little better than she was when she was here. She got some company. She's around people a little more often now. And she seems to be moving forward, but you know, she's not young. So, Jeannie, if you're watching, we love you too. Anybody else? Anything else?
I have a praise. My son shot, finally went back to work after the fire, so.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Is that Whitefall?
Yes.
Whitefall products? Passed by them yesterday.
Yeah, employment's a big deal right now. If you're not, you're in big trouble.
I've been in excruciating pain the last week in my hip.
Why don't you just make him sleep somewhere else? Sorry, Mike. Who else? Thought I heard somebody. Got a bruise, needs healing. We'll get you covered. We got you covered. All right, let's bow our heads real quick. Lord, it seems the list just goes on and on. There's still people that we love very much that aren't here. We think of Jeannie. We thank Ginger for being here as well, Lord. We miss her as well. But we also miss Pat and Ray and so many others that we have come used to see. And Lord, we don't know what's going on in their lives per se, but we sure do hope that you would hold them close and give them peace. Today we think of Carlos, Lord, and what a tremendous amount of pain to fall face first onto steps and have just so many things going on. And when you're so mature and fragile, just pray that you would hold him close, Lord. For Urbana Reformed, Lord, we saw on the news yesterday and today what happens, and boy, Lord, they sure need to see your work. They need to feel your presence now more than ever. May you be with them, give them hope and peace. help them rebuild and start anew. Lord, for Sandy and Andy, we miss them. Such bright people in our midst when they're here, and just a huge part of our family already. Pray that you would comfort them and make them well. Lord, we thank you so much for Carol. Her contribution here has been felt since day one. And Lord, I would dare say that a large part of who I am may be because of her and her husband. So we pray, Lord, that you would heal them as well and bring them home. For Kristen, Lord, we pray that you would help her. Make her well as well, and let her be back to work soon. Lord, for Don's son's shop, man, it's a good thing that they opened back up and he's got an opportunity. And Lord, we see your hand at work in our daily lives as you move things along in the world around us. And while we have challenges that we face, we know that you're there and that you're present at every move. So we thank you for your answered prayer. For Anne and her pain, and her daughter who is also feeling pain, Lord, we just pray that you would heal both of them, give them strength, and help them along their way. Lord, there's so many others, so many things that are not said in this room right now. So many worries and fears, some just manifested by an uncertainty, a lack of knowing what's coming for sure. And Lord, that's when we need you the most. When we don't know the answer, when we don't know what's coming, and if we rely on you, we have nothing to fear. So Lord, I pray that you would hold us close and in the palm of your hands today, and take all of these requests and all of these people and bless each one. In your name, Lord. Amen. It's all you.
Good morning, family.
Good morning.
This morning's scripture is from Acts chapter 10, verses 9 through 16. When Pastor asked me to read this week, and I read it, I don't ever remember reading this before, and I'm interested to see what your take is on this. Peter's vision. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up onto the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. And while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles of the earth and birds of the air. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter replied. "I've never eaten anything impure or unclean." The voice spoke to him a second time, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back up into heaven.
All right. You're going to have to stand up again. Fill my cup, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tim, Lisa, and all of you. You notice we never mention money, but we do have the offering plates out here, one here and one in the back. And the Lord has continued to be faithful to us through pandemic, and now we're back together again. Good morning, Josh. And his lovely bride, her friend. So glad you're here. And Ginger. This past week, I want you to stay in the gospel or the letter of Acts written by Dr. Luke, the person who wrote the Acts of the Apostles, is the same person who wrote the Gospel Luke, Dr. Luke. Luke was a doctor. And so he gives us a perspective different than the other Gospels. And it is a record of what the apostles did. Actually, I told somebody this morning, we're going to go through the whole chapter, chapter 10 this morning. I guess I told Les that. He said, in 25 minutes? He didn't believe me. So we're going to go through them because there are some interesting things here. And you see, the title is Real Ministry. And I want to preface this by, last week I had the privilege of going to a high school concert. And I want to, before I say what I'm going to say, I want people to know that it was at Warner Shores. Our granddaughters, three of them, were in the concert, and that's why we went. And they were good. Musically, they've been trained. Beautiful voices from the choir. Beautiful voices. But I sat there and listened, and the music that had been chosen, I don't know by who, probably the teachers, but I have never been in a concert of young people with such despair. Kids today and our whole world are reaching out for substance, for meaning, for answers. We live in a tough world. Those of us that are more mature, we remember the Cold War vividly and how many folks built bomb shelters underground in case of a nuclear attack. And we lived through it, and thank God we never had to experience those things that others have. But we kind of rebounded and lived our lives, and today we've got wars, you know, and rumors of wars everywhere. I should say something about, during our prayer time, I should have asked, we're all concerned about the Ukraine and Russia. We probably don't understand the dynamics of the reasons for the war or whatever else. But I want you to know, we belong to the IFCA, Independent Fundamental Churches of America. It's an association of over 1,200 churches worldwide. We have several Bible churches, just like this one, and in some cases called Bible Baptist, in Russia. Now, I don't know who's to fault for the war. I don't care. Well, I do care, but I don't know. We also have six specific churches that meet in the Ukraine. They're believers. And I know we take political sides. But all around the world, people are looking for answers. Is this all there is? We get up and go to work in the morning? And I want you to see something, because if nothing else, it emphasized to me as I listened to that concert the need for ministry. It starts in the first part of Acts chapter 10. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in the Italian regiment of the Roman Empire. Elsewhere, all the way through Scripture, in the New Testament letters that Paul wrote, and he as soon is to become the focal point of Acts, but in this time, the Roman Empire was ruler, the Caesars were called gods. Things were rough. And here's a Roman centurion of the Italian regiment, and the church had now expanded from what we would know as the Gaza Strip, and had, after Pentecost, they began to move, the Christians began to go back home, up around the Mediterranean Sea over into Italy. And the church was growing and prospering, but somehow, look what it says about him. This Italian Roman guy, he and all his family were devout and God-fearing, and he gave generously to those who were in need. And he did that because he went to church. I don't know where he went to church. Probably in a home church. I don't know. But he, like so many of our world today, do the right stuff. They get up, they go to work, they come home, they raise their families, they do their best to raise families, and we're confronted with all kinds of issues from health to social uplift, economic despair, jobs in jeopardy, all around. And here's what I think he said. Is this all there is? I give and I give and I give. One day, about three, he had a vision. He was looking to God for answers. And he distinctly saw an angel of God who came to him and said, Cornelius. And notice how he answered, what is it, Lord? That tells me that here was a New Testament appearance of Christ after he resurrected. In the Old Testament, we have Jesus appearing all kinds of times, but we call them in the Old Testament, when he appeared, a theophany. T-H-E-O-P-H-A-N-Y. It's an Old Testament, or it's an appearance of Christ. And I think here, Jesus from heaven, Cornelius, this really good guy, but he doesn't know me. Cornelius, yeah, what? He said, your prayers and gifts have come up me as a memorial. Now send men to Joppa and bring back a man named Simon. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea. When the angel spoke to him and had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and said, we're going to Joppa. That's a seaport town. Not the place you would go to look for religion. It was a seaport town, and very important. Now, what this tells me is this. America has been called, and rightfully so, for years and years and years, a Christian country, based upon the fact of our foundational beliefs, the Ten Commandments. Our law is based upon the Ten Commandments, whether the idiots who are educated beyond their intelligence tell you this, it is. The Constitution was framed around the principles of God's Word. The laws were written because we needed the laws. Why do we have so many laws? Because we need the laws. Nobody had a speed limit when it was horse and buggies. We had cars, we added laws. You can't go so fast. And then we say, well, you can't go through intersections without stopping. So now we got laws about stop signs. And everywhere in life, we get the government that we need and deserve. There's all kinds of rules. And this Cornelius was just a guy looking for answers. And I submit to you that we have the answer. Now look what happened. You have the story that was read. There's a preparation for ministry. How many people do we know that are looking for answers? Real answers. We've got families in trouble today, folks, everywhere. In this little church, in the larger church, Forest Park, at Trinity Baptist over here, at what used to be Kine down here, Port City Church down here, Broadway Baptist. Families are in distress, struggling with answers. Teenagers, these kids in the choir, they one song was about a little black girl, I assume a black girl that was part of the Ugandan problem in Africa. And just her heart, she wrote a poem, and that became the song of desperation. People around us are looking for answers. Now, this is an interesting story. All of a sudden, we switch from Cornelius to Peter. And anytime we sense a need, we need to be prepared to meet that need. And a lot of people poo-hoo that, you know. Well, I reminded of way back in Bible college, and there was a young man, his name was Bob Lazar. A little short guy, he was older than most of us. He was a married man then. He probably wasn't much older than us, but he was married. And he came in to school, and we would study frantically for our exams, and he'd walk around the halls, and really was a disturbance. We met in the commons, and we were studying and cramming for exams. He says, Bob, you ready for the test? Oh, yeah, if the Lord wants me to pass that, he'll give me the answers. I'm just trusting in God. Well, he flunked out of school. Didn't last long. Never forget it. Now, I don't believe it was God's will that he failed the test. God had a plan and wants us to be prepared. Look what he did. And a voice saw the sheet come down. We don't know who held it, but it came down. It was filled with animals. Now, this is a vision from God. It was designed to prepare Peter. Peter was a Jew, a real Jew. He was an Israelite, really, and he obeyed the law. He wouldn't ever have eaten a snake, a lizard. Frog legs were out. He would never have eaten goat meat or pigs or bacon. Don't you feel sorry for somebody who can't eat bacon? That's just wrong. He would never have done that because he was a Christian. I think Peter was one of those guys that, had we met him at first, we would have said, Peter, you're oversaved. Because he took it serious. And God said, Peter, you're hungry. Now, he must have really been hungry. How many of you have a point in every day where you know you need to eat or you're going to get a headache? Yeah. Okay? And we know. And Peter was hungry. Now, I don't know what the problem was with Peter, but it says he was so hungry, he was almost in a trance. And I envision this trance. Most of us are more mature folks. When we get up real quick from sitting down, do you get dizzy? Thank God I'm not alone. And that's kind of what Peter was. He was starved, or thought he was. And so the Lord God from heaven said, hey, Peter, you're getting ready to eat. Take something, kill it, prepare it. And Peter said, Lord, there's goats in there, and there's pigs in there, and there's snakes in there, and there's lizards in there, and you know I can't eat that. Arguing with God is not a good deal. You're going to lose. The Lord, Peter said, I've never eaten anything. And then the Lord said, don't call anything impure or unclean that God has made clean. I want you to understand, when Jesus said, or the Bible records, God so loved the world that he gave his only son for the world. He means everybody. Now, I don't know where God has called you or to call to, but there's got to be preparation, and this was Peter's. This thing happened three times to him, and after the third time, the sheep disappeared, the animals disappeared, and I always wondered, I still wonder, after having this week, I've read this passage over and over and over again, and I still wonder, what if Peter had taken the animal? Was it a real animal, or was it just a dream? Jesus told him, take and eat. So he could have said, okay, boy, that looks like a good, that looks, I'm going to have some bacon. I don't know what would have happened. I don't know, but I know that God was trying to point something out. While Peter was still wondering about the meaning of the vision, Cornelius, the Roman, what all the way through the epistles are called pagans, came to his house. God had to get Peter ready to talk to a pagan. How do we view them? I was born and raised in Granville. We had one black person in our high school. One. It was a big high school. Big for that day. We had one black kid. So as a result, I didn't think I was racist, and I still don't think I was, because I never had any contact with the other cultures around me. But nonetheless, we moved to Muskegon sometime later, and I got a job to support me while I was preaching at smaller churches like this one that didn't pay me. And so I had to have a job, and I took a job called Debit Insurance. I was a salesman for Detroit Mutual and Monumental Life. And that's a debit company, which means the insurance man, some of you older folks remember when the insurance man came every week to collect, or every month to collect the premium. In those days, it was $1.50 or 35 cents or whatever it was. But my territory was over in the projects here in Muskegon, Muskegon Heights. Marilyn worried about me, prayed for me every day that I went, because I collected money in the Heights. And I found out something. It's a different culture than I was used to. And it was real easy for me to ask our church or churches to support the ministry of missionaries who go to Africa. Minister to the Africans, the cultures over there. But to go into the projects? And what I learned was their mamas and their grandmas love their kids just like I love mine. And they're as concerned about the welfare, and they're concerned about gunshots and guns and crime and immorality, and they're as concerned about that as we are. I wasn't prepared for that. Because in our minds, that's a different culture. And because, now, I'm not a proponent of white supremacy. I'm not a proponent for any of that. We come from different cultures. But God prepares us for the mission field he sends us. What would happen? And we'll get there. This was Peter's preparation for ministry beyond what he ever dreamed. It was real easy for Peter to spread the gospel to his buddies in the Israeli community. He knew them. He knew their culture. He says, you don't have to be circumcised. You just have to trust Jesus. You don't have to pay the tithe. You just have to trust Jesus. You don't have to go to Sunday Sabbath school for them. You just have to trust Jesus. That's easy. But to go to a pagan? One of the reasons we enjoy racetrack ministry is because I've always said it is the only ministry I've ever been involved with, other than church ministry, where they come to you and ask you to pray for them. That is so cool. Now, they're praying. Some of them want you to pray they win. Someone wants you to pray their car will just make it through this week until I can fix it. And it's so cool. So there was a really cultural difference, but nonetheless, it is so important that God prepared Peter. Peter went down, and he's a little bit hesitant, I think. He went downstairs because they were at the door. He says, what do you want? Why have you come? That's in verse 21. We have come from Cornelius, the centurion, he said. He's a God-fearing man And he's respected by the Jewish people because of his gifts and so on. But an angel said, there's got to be something more than this. And I want to hear what you have to say, Peter. Now I want to ask you, who is your Cornelius? Different world, different culture. It doesn't have to be something spectacular. It doesn't have to be black, white, Hispanic. It doesn't have to be cross-cultural. But God brings people into your life to minister to. He brings them into my life to minister to. Who is it? And why are they there? Because they have questions, just like those high school choir kids did. Well, God doesn't do anything without a plan. God has a plan for you. In fact, if you used to be involved, or there was an organization called Campus Crusade for Christ. And they came out with an evangelistic plan called the Four Spiritual Laws. And the first of the laws in the four spiritual, the plan, is God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And the rest is the plan of salvation, all of sin and so on. And it's a wonderful plan. But that truth is evidenced in this passage. God has a plan for you. Who has he brought into your life lately? I don't know. Where did God put you? To whom do you minister? And how? We have to be aware that many times God allows people into our life who were just there because you were there. And they're looking for answers. That doesn't mean we pick apart their life. When somebody is struggling, we seek to be and have the ministry of reconciliation. Beatitudes. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called what? The children of God. Do you want to be called a child of God? Be a peacemaker, because that's what they're called. That means we make peace at home. That means we have to settle differences, reconcile the differences together. If we can't keep peace at home, how can we keep peace outside the home? Making peace many times means forgiveness. Many times it means perhaps confrontation. My dad always told me, he says, the reason you're getting spanked, is because before you can have peace, you have to make a little war. Well, we're in a war. People are desperate, and they're acting like Cornelius, and on the outside, we make it look like we've got it all together. But there's not one of us that doesn't have an extended family somewhere, or friends, or our family at work, that we call friends and we work with that are struggling with something, and God has prepared you. Now, you may not be a marriage counselor. You can't do that. It goes beyond your expertise or ability, but you can tell them, I love you and I'm praying for you. You can tell them, I know the answer, or I know somebody who has the answer. God prepared Peter. The next day, Peter said, okay, I'm going to go with you. And the plan for this ministry, and he got to Cornelius's house. Finally got there. Cornelius saw him, and he fell down on his knees and bowed before Peter. Peter says, stand up. I'm just a man like you. I'm no better or no worse than you. Peter was an apostle. Formerly, he had been a fisherman. He was a rough guy. And he went there, he said, stand up, I'm mulling myself. And then Peter went out, and you look at verse 28, Peter said to them, you're well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or to visit him, but God has shown me that I cannot call any man impure or unclean. You talk about the solving of a cultural difference. Our God sees no difference in the cultures from which we come. Our God, Peter preached, and he says, when I was sent for, I came without raising. Why did he come without raising an objection? Because God had prepared him. God had prepared him for this ministry. And he said, Then Paul said, well, why did you, or Peter said, why did you ask me to come? And he says, well, four days ago, I was in the house praying at this hour, and suddenly a man said, I need what you got. So I sent for you immediately in verse 33. And then now we're all here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded us. Now, what did he do? He gave him the plan of salvation, folks. Peter was not a theologian. Remember that. If there was a theologian in the apostolic ministry, it was Paul. Paul was educated by Gamaliel. Paul was educated in the things of the Jewish and Israelites' law. He knew the Bible. That would be Paul. Peter was a fisherman. Now, he knew the Ten Commandments and he knew about the sacrifices, but he did those by rote until Jesus said, hey, Peter, follow me. So what did Peter preach? Jesus. He just talked about Jesus. That's all. He talked about Jesus, how Jesus saved him, how Jesus chose him, and Jesus is the answer. Now, I've said that many times, that Jesus is the answer. Yeah, what's the question? The biggest question is, how do I have hope? How do I have hope? Everybody wants hope. The other day I was over at Wesco on the corner of Glenside and Sherman. And I stood in a line, you know how the line there, anybody that goes over there or any Wesco, they got one checkout it seemed like, and you're lined up. And the holdup, three little ladies buying lottery tickets. A lady that, I can't afford to buy them. $100 she spent. I'll take two of those and four of those, and I want two of those. $100! Now, why did she buy lottery tickets? Because she wanted hope. I hope I win and be on Easy Street. Everybody wants hope. I hope that when I get home tonight, my wife's not mad. Everybody wants hope. Where does hope come from? Well, it comes from Jesus. And forgiveness. Being forgiven. And forgiving. Now, what does that come with it? I'm forgiven, and what do I get? I get the blessed hope. Because Jesus has forgiven me, I can walk into the presence of heaven. I have hope. Now, that's the basis. Now, that sounds pretty pie in the sky, doesn't it? Sounds like, oh boy, well, you just trust Jesus and all your problems will be over. No, your problems won't be over. But Jesus will see you through those because of those wonderful acts of forgiveness. Now, if he forgives and he gives to us the ministry of reconciliation, and he says, if you're a peacemaker, I'll call you a child of God or a Christian, then we'd perhaps better do that. But the plan was for Peter to minister to him. Well, then we got to go someplace else. Because with the plan, God gives power. Verses 30 to 38, I sent for you immediately, and God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit, and how he went about because God was with him. And if you'll follow the rest of the story, down in verse 46, it says, "For they heard them," the people who had gathered to hear Peter preach, because God had prepared him to go to a culture totally different than what he was used to. God had prepared him. And then God's Holy Spirit took over. And they were there praising God. Verse 43, "All of the prophets testified about him. Everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." And then in verse 46, "For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God." Now, the tongues, why did they have... Did you understand that?
No.
But the people there did. And it wasn't gibberish. It wasn't some heavenly language. It was language that they used to communicate and praise God because they were cross-culture. Different cultures have different languages. Yeah. Josh cuts down trees. He says words about trees, and what he does is lift. You still cut down trees, don't you? No? Not anymore? Oh, okay. Well, he used to. He lost the language. I'm sorry. I'll tell you this, when we started at Racetrack Ministry, we didn't know anything about, they talked about all kinds of stuff that I never heard before. What's a stagger? Well, that's what a drunk does. He staggers. Well, that's the difference in the right side and the left side tires, okay? I heard and learned language. I'm tight, I'm loose, I'm pushing. You gotta learn a language. Because it's a different culture, if you want to minister. And that's what Paul did, and that's what happened. Now, the tongues here obviously were used for communicating the gospel, and they sang praises in their own tongues, and they praised God. Why? Because the gospel has power and gives hope. The gospel has power and gives hope. So God has a plan for us. And that leads us to this one. Who do you know that God has placed into your life this week? God's got a plan for you. How are you going to spread the gospel today? Well, who should I talk to? Who did God put in my life? Is it the guy next to me at work? Is it the place where I go bowl? Is it where you golf? Nobody's done much of that lately. And Lord, if anybody needs prayer, it's the golfers. Is it to take some of those singers from a choir that have just expressed hopelessness and say, Jesus is the answer. He'll give you forgiveness. He'll give you hope. He'll give you strength. He'll give you life that can be abundant, even in troubles. I want you this week to list some of the people, some of the places that God has put into your life. But this is real gospel. We don't get a lot of doctrine out of the book of Acts because it is simply what it says. It's the Acts of the Apostles and how they built the church. They laid the foundation, and Jesus is Lord. So, the thing we see about this is that God doesn't ever put in your life a situation or a place or a person to whom you can't minister. If we remember, don't ever call something that God said he loved impure and untouchable. Maybe you are the one to touch their life with the gospel of hope. Our God is good. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are a good God all the time. Thank you, Lord, that we can know you and share you And you don't put us in any situation where we will not and have not been prepared for that situation if we just trust you and obey. Peter, of course, was prepared because he obeyed. He exercised his plan because you gave it to him. And he had the power of the Holy Spirit to see him through these troubling times. Help us to pursue others, even as you. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand up as we close with the song. It's page 371 in the hymn books, but the words are here, three verses. God is so good. Spirit of God be with you now, forever, in Jesus' name, amen.